This session is about Professor Satish Chandra and the new tyrannies. And the two speakers in this session are Professor Ranabir Chakravarty from the Center for Historical Studies, JNU, and Professor Farhat Hassan from the History Department of Delhi University. I request Professor Ranabir Chakravarty to make his presentation now.
The chairperson of this session, Professor Kumkum Roy, my co-panelist, Professor Farhat Hassan, distinguished members of the audience, friends, colleagues, students, I'm indeed very deeply grateful and touched by the request from the Center for Historical Studies to say a few words on the late lamented Professor Satish Chandra. And I thought of talking about him in terms of his contribution to and inspiring us, of course, for the study of Indian Ocean history. This is a field which Professor Satish Chandra developed rather late in his academic life, at least in the written words that we have come across from his pen. Essentially a historian of medieval India, a historian of land-based polity, Professor Satish Chandra was gradually being drawn to the study of the Indian Ocean, perhaps from the 80s. He would be one person, if I borrow the words of Ashin Das Gupta, that one land-based historian who would not be uncomfortable with the salty breeze from the sea. This was, I very briefly saw him in Kolkata when he was the chairman of the QGC, came for inaugurating a meeting at my alma mater, Calcutta University, but obviously that was only a sighting. I came to know of his works, apart from Mughal history, when in 1987, a book edited by him, The Indian Ocean, History, Commerce and Politics, came out. This was a period, as Professor Thapar was telling, exciting times for us who were interested in maritime history and India. The situation was, within a range of 5 years, came five remarkable books, one of them being Satish Chandra's edited one I have mentioned. 1985 came Chaudhary's book, India and the Commerce, Trade and Civilization in the Indian Ocean, from the rise of Islam to 1750. Then Ashin Das Gupta and Mehmet Pearson's edited India and the Indian Ocean, 1500-1800. Third came 1987, Satish Chandra's edited volume. And then 1990, the sequel volume of Kane Chaudhary, that is Asia Before Europe, all related to Indian Ocean. It was something of a feast for us. What immediately struck and differentiated Satish Chandra from other works is that in this volume, for the first time, we, at that time, first getting the taste of the waves of the Indian Ocean, got something about the pre-1500 scenario. Even someone with the great brilliance and sophistication of the Indian Ocean under Ashin Das Gupta's editorship didn't have a chapter anything beyond Genevieve Bouchon and then Lombard's chapter, India and the Indian Ocean, 15th century. If you open the page of this Indian Ocean History, Commerce and Politics, there is a remarkable chapter by Charles Berlin. I do not know what happened to the gentleman. Perhaps Satish Chandra found this jewel out of somewhere. I never saw many articles from Berlin then, but that was a wonderful overview, pre-1500 scenario. He brought about another chapter by Notika Varadarajan. Once again, Notika is no more. Essentially, a historian of textile products. Notika was was sort of brought into this Indian Ocean history in this book in a very strong way, giving the overview from 900 to 1600. And then came a remarkable paper by Leslie Gunawardha from Sri Lanka, highlighting sea waste to Sicily. Now these were for us something of a very major inspiration that yes, someone looking at the Indian Ocean prior to 1500, can we do it? Satish Saab's work actually gave us that kind of encouragement. Though at that time, being based in Kolkata, doing my PhD under Professor Shireen Mousvi, I had no chance to meet him, to talk to him. I knew him through his works. Then by 1993, came out another volume edited by Satish Saab, which was the, this was jointly edited with B. Alulasha and Surya Narayan, 93. This was India Ocean and its islands. This was also a very major point of departure. Indian Ocean, we talk of trade and politics, sometimes Indian Ocean regarding maritime Southeast Asia, Indian Ocean with the trading network with Arab world and the East African coast, of course, Indian Ocean under the joint stock compacts. But who talks about the islands? It was Satish Saab's innovative idea of bringing in the islands in the study of the Indian Ocean. And to this, I must say, Satish Saab's ability to work with diverse types of people of diverse disciplines. And that is particularly at large the way he brought in B. Arunachal, a geographer actually, from Bombay University, but who turned out as the best exponent of the study of the traditional navigation and maritime technology by reading the Gujarati Pothis of 18th, 19th century, of the use of how the sextant is used and thalamus by the indigenous navigators of the navigators of the Thaos. So this was something we were stunned. And the way the islands shaped the situation of the Indian Ocean, that he was trying to do. I do not know what actually drew Satish Saab towards the Indian Ocean. Was it because of his very long and sustained association in Paris in the 1970s and 80s at the kind of Maison of the Human Sciences when he was in association with International History, the Congress of History Writing as the Executive Board? Is it the influence of Lelian ideas in France and at that time? There are allegories there, whether that drew him to the Indian Ocean, but we were immensely benefited even before I knew him. It was in 2004, thanks to the kindness of Professor Dilbagh Singh of our center, that I was first introduced. Dilbagh Singh knew my interest in Indian Ocean. A seminar was about to be organized on Indian Ocean, and Dilbagh Singh introduced to me. Introduced me to Satish Saab. And then, from then onwards, at least on three occasions, he was very kind to ask me to participate in a seminar, to present something, and his keen interest in the Indian Ocean far into the ancient times, and then coming right up to the current scenario of the Indian Ocean. That was the hallmark. This is something he tried to do even when he was the editor, the founding and the continuous editor of the Journal of the Indian Ocean Studies, in which, though essentially historically he broke the boundaries, he brought in, and it was not a journal of history per se. Historians did come and contribute, but there was environmentalists writing on the danger of deep sea fishing in the Indian Ocean, on the marine life in the long run, the effect of the tsunami, the possibility of the monsoon if the Indian Ocean goes under some problems because of environmental reasons, how it could affect the entire monsoon Asia. These he would very much welcome. That's why when I met him last year, 2000, 2016 in one of the conferences in Delhi. I was invited as a speaker. I found him in company, as usual, of diverse disciplined people. Like there would be, he would always like to bring in the people from the Navy, not merely for indicating the naval power of Indian India, but how the Navy people would look at the sea. Is it important for social scientists and historians? And vice versa. So there would be Vice Admiral N.K. Roy in those meetings. There also I met Vice Admiral Anup Singh, a very important naval officer who was earlier at Vishakhapatnam, in charge of the Vishakhapatnam Naval Command of the Eastern Seaboard. There would be, as I say, geographers like Arunachalam, there would be historians, of course, but also will bring in diplomats to bring in the question of Indian Ocean and repeatedly pointing out that this, the study of the Indian Ocean is meant not merely to look for the glorious past of India and the subcontinent, unlike what have been repeatedly being told in present day RSS type and Sanghi type of historiography, that look at the past, how glorious it was, never talking what the present is or what the future will be. That was never Satish Chandra's agenda. And the ability to bring in diverse people from diverse discipline and opinion on the same board speaks of his remarkable ability to get the best out of everyone. I was myself a beneficiary of his kindness, and I would simply say, at the very the image I got, last year I was speaking on the Indian Ocean scenario, and I spoke briefly, touched upon merely because of the shortage of time, on the importance of the Solutra Island in the pre-1500 Indian Ocean network, on the basis of some epigraphic records and the 13th century Latin crusade tractate. So this saw in a definitely failing health, fragile, bound to the wheelchair, speaking in whisper, I could see that suddenly his eyes just glistened up. And he picked up those information and called me over during the lunch break and asked me, these seem to be rather new trends in understanding of the Sahutra, because when the book in 1993, edited by jointly by Satish Chandra with Arunachalam and Surya Narayan, came, not so much information about Sahutra, so where did you get it? I sat down with him and he was quite insistent on my visiting him and talking more on this. Sadly, I missed it out. It is my failure that I was unable to do that. But if Satish Chandra is to be remembered, particularly at this moment, what I spoke about is involvement with Indian Ocean studies. There is one connection in the Center for Historical Studies, I do not know by what coincidence, in this dry, I would call it often dust capital of India, and beside a river which is now reduced to a nala, we have in this center five or six people deeply interested in the history of Indian Ocean, cutting across centuries. Perhaps there lies from somewhere the vibes we got from Satish Chandra's work. Though by this time he had no ties, academic or professional ties with JV, he left us for us this treasure. And my only point is, by remembering him, I would like to tell particularly younger people, for whom I have very high hopes, that please, if you look at as a student of history or as social science at Indian Ocean, please do not fall into the trap of repeatedly telling how once upon a time India was ruling over Indian Ocean and then later we got sort of subordinated by foreign forces. This love for chauvinism, unfortunately, I would like to state this categorically, I have heard on very former these seminars in the presence of this university's very high authorities, including the Vice Chancellor, that younger people aspirant for higher things would suddenly jump into Indian Ocean scenario telling how India was almost civilizing Southeast Asian countries. By this, once again, the Sanghi type of historiography and ideology is trying to bring back, they only can bring back revivalism. Only revival, nothing newness of the age-old discarded Greater India Society theory. One has to recall, and particularly Satish Sahab reminded us, cautioned us, that the lifespan of this Greater India Society had only 30 years. 1925 it started, in the 1920s, by the time Southeast Asian countries became independent, the death knell of Greater India Society has come. This is the, perhaps the lesson one has to repeatedly learn from Satish Sahab and his followers, his compatriots, his comrades. And it is to that memory that we bow down to his immense ability. Even when he was, his infirmity gripped him, he was ever at the front row of extending the horizon of historical studies and also always standing very upright on the dangers of obscurantism and the chauvinist agenda that is now being repeatedly thrust upon us. We have to take care and guard against this by following the steps, principles and the agenda such as our form. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Ranabir. I now invite Professor Farhat Hassan to make his presentation. Would that be good for that? Yes.
Thank you very much for having me here. Let me begin by reiterating